With Storyline's text entry field, you can capture the learner's name and then use that name to later personalize the content in your course. You can use it to personalize introductions, scenarios, quizzes, feedback, and more. Now, what happens after users figure out how to capture the learner name and use it, they tend to want to make a few customizations. So we'll look at three common questions that come up after users set up their first text entry field to capture the learner name. So the first and probably most common question that comes up is, okay, cool. I don't want learners to be able to jump ahead in the course until they've entered something in the field. So a couple things we have to do here. We have to evaluate when this text entry field is completed. And so allowing the learner to only move forward when this variable, which is first name, we already set that up here, when this is not blank. So here's what it looks like. The first thing I would probably do is just to make this easier for our learners, really, so they have an idea of why they can't move forward, would be to set the next button to disabled. And we can do that by coming down here to the states panel. And I've got a disabled state already applied, so I'll just change my initial state right here, and we'll just choose disabled. What that means is as soon as the slide loads here now, this button is gonna be in that disabled state. So what we wanna do is enable this to normal when the learner enters something into the text field. We don't wanna have to evaluate all the possible alphanumeric combinations. We're just gonna say, you have to enter something here, that's good enough for us. Whatever you put in here, this is what we're gonna call you for the rest of the course. Okay, so here's what it looks like. We want to ask ourselves always, we always do this when we're working with triggers, so a new trigger. What is it I want to do? I want to change the state of my next button. So change the state of what? My next button to normal. And then when do I want to do that? Not when we click something. We want to evaluate the focus of this text entry field. So our event would be when the object loses focus. So this is the same trigger that we use to adjust the variable that Storyline actually creates for us automatically when we type something into that field. So when object loses focus of the label, but of our text entry field. Now, just because the object loses focus, that's not enough. That's automatically going to change the next button to normal. We need to evaluate if the learner actually typed something in. So for that, we want a condition, and the condition would be if our first name, that's the name of the variable that we're using for our text entry field, if it's not blank. So here's my little equals, and it doesn't really matter if we use the ignore case because blank is blank. So whether you spell, whether it's blank, it has to be a nothing. There's no case, right? If not, it's not equal to blank. So as long as when the learner clicks out of here and there's something typed in there, even if it's a single letter, single character, that'll change our next button. So let's try this out real quick and see. So we'll type in, we'll just drop our cursor in and let's move out. Control has lost focus, nothing. I say, my name is Dave. As soon as I lose focus, now I have access to the next button and I can move forward. Cool. Okay, let's look at another example, another way that we can customize this. I'm gonna remove the states that we just added. So I'm gonna put it back to normal and I'm gonna delete this condition, right? This trigger right here to change the next button to normal. Because maybe you want to provide some more info to the learner to let them know why they can't move forward. So we could keep the button set to normal, but this time we're going to evaluate if, same thing, if there's something typed in here or not. But when the learner clicks the next button, rather than moving forward, we're gonna say, show an alert layer. And this alert layer is just gonna basically pop up, reminding the learner to enter their name before continuing. So we give them a little bit more context about around why they can't move forward. So here's what that looks like. So the next button has a trigger that says jump to the next slide when you click the next button. Cool, that works great. We know how that works. That's old hat. Now what we wanna do is use another trigger on here that doesn't jump into the next slide, but we wanna show that alert layer if they click the next button and this is blank. So here we go. So new trigger, what is it I wanna do? I wanna show a layer and I'm gonna say show a layer alert when when user clicks the next button, the button next, if the first name is equal to blank. If it's blank and the learner clicks that button, then show me the layer. Now, we also want to add a condition for the jump to the next slide trigger as well, because we only want to allow the learner to jump to the next slide if what? If this field is not blank. So we have show a layer if they click the next button. If it's blank, good, but then only allow the learner to move to the next slide if this, the text entry field is not blank. So let's just double click the existing trigger just to make a small edit. We want to add a condition here. So this time we're going to say if the first name is not equal to blank. We don't want to have to have 100 different conditions to evaluate what's typed in there. Unless, of course, this was a quiz and there's certain types of acceptable answers, then we could add conditions for all of that. But here we're asking the learner for their name. We want to trust that whatever they enter here in this field is good enough for us. That's what we're going to call you. So may as well trust them to put their proper name in here, and that's what we'll refer to them. So we just want to know that it's not blank. Now, in this case, trigger order isn't going to matter. These are going to fire, and we'll see that it doesn't matter whether this first one is set up first or second, because what we want to do is that because that condition is evaluating when these will be true. So we're not going to do both of these. So let's just select both of those slides, and then we'll say preview the selected slides and give it a try here. So first thing I want to do to test it, I'm just going to try to click next and see what happens. There's my slide layer with my little reminder, my little alert reminding me to type in something. So cool. Then I'll just type in, wait, caps lock is on, didn't even know that. And now if I click next, then hey, David, nice to meet you. So that's how we can ensure that the learner can't move forward again, but this time giving them a little bit more context around the why they have to do that rather than just keeping that next button completely disabled. All right, one more example. So for this one, I'm going to say, let's take this off. I will delete that last trick. I'll turn that off right there, and then I'll come in here and just delete that condition. So another question that comes up is, I don't want a next button. I just want the learner to click return on the keyboard, and that's how they can move forward. So it's pretty much the same process here. In this case, we don't even need any of this next button because we are going to use a keystroke, right? To navigate and move forward. So let's say new trigger, and we'll say jump to slide, next slide. When, in this case, user presses a key. We don't see this trigger a lot, but this is totally valid. We'll say user presses a key, and I'm just going to put my cursor in here. I'm going to press the return key. There it is. There's my enter. After clicking on the slide, that's totally fine. But just like before, we need to evaluate that there's something in this text entry field. So we'll say if that first name is not equal to blank. Cool. So what's really cool about these little variations when you're practicing Storyline is that you start to see that a lot of the events and the conditions are the same. It's the context or the event that's different, right? The event could be clicking a next button. It could be pressing an enter key on the keyboard. All these events are a little different, but overall, the same technical skill is being applied. You're just kind of mixing and matching. So that's why I like these questions. It's also a good reason why you might want to keep an e-learning toolkit available where you have different versions of each of these ways to move forward, you know, after evaluating whether the text entry field has been completed. So let's just test this out before, let's make sure it works before I congratulate myself. So selected slides. And I don't have one to show that alert layer, but that would be a good idea to go back and add that. So you can click in here, click out, click return, nothing. Type in David, press enter, and then now it moves forward. So probably what I would do here, if I tried to hit enter, I'd probably want some instructions for the learner to say, you know, type your name and then press enter, would be also maybe to show the alert layer if there's nothing in this field, right? So we could say one more time. Show layer, alert when user presses the enter key on this slide if, in this case, first name is equal to blank, right? One more time, preview the selected slides. So let's say I try to press enter, and there's my please enter your name, right? And we'll try it one more time. Perfect, there we go. So just a couple ways that you can further customize working with text entry fields to personalize your course, but then also some ways to mix up how the learner moves forward in the course based on clicking buttons, pressing the enter key, or even combinations of both to also show alerts or disabled states. Hope that helps. And if you have any questions, just let me know in the comments below. Thanks.